every spoken word, what your soul has longed for, what your heart can feel, is already here, is already real.
There is no one out there, there is no one else. You hold all the answers deep inside of yourself. There's a voice that whispers, there's no you, no me. There's just one. There's just unity.
Good morning and welcome to Unity of Ventura's online Sunday service. My name is Sherry Lieberg. I'll be your hostess this morning, but if you like, you can think of me as your own little personal Christmas elf. Great thanks to each of you for honoring the call of your heart to join us. We know that you could be out shopping or wrapping gifts or watching football or sleeping in, but instead you chose to lend your presence and your consciousness, and for that we are most grateful. As you know, today is the last Sunday in Advent, which is a time of expectant preparation and waiting for the celebration of the birth of Jesus. Today we focus on the gift of joy as we light the Advent calendar. Now, in my early days of metaphysics, I used to get confused between happiness and joy. And if you've ever wandered down that little path of bewilderment, I'm going to offer you some tidbits that might help you distinguish between the two. Joy is in the heart. Happiness is on the face. Joy is of the soul. Happiness is of the moment. Joy is a practice and a behavior. It's deliberate and intentional. Happiness comes and goes blithely along its way. Joy is profound and scriptural. Do not worry, rejoice. Happiness is like a superficial balm. Don't worry, be happy. Joy is an inner feeling. Happiness is an outward expression. A person pursues happiness, but chooses joy. So it is with deep joy that I invite you to take a moment and remember why we're here today. It's because we come together in one mind and one heart in order to create and experience a higher consciousness, a greater consciousness. And when we do that, spiritual magic happens. So please know your presence, your participation, your consciousness are so important and so appreciated. The mission of Unity of Ventura is to provide a loving and accepting environment that inspires spiritual and personal growth through the practice of unity principles as taught by our co-founders, Charles and Myrtle Fillmore. Grounded in those teachings, we come together welcoming people of all faiths, all religious upbringings, all backgrounds, all lifestyles, all ways of thinking, all opinions, and that is why we are called Unity. So please, let's now take a moment to go deeper within into our hearts in our opening prayer. Sweet Spirit, as we focus on joy this last Sunday in Advent, we remember that this is an experience of joy that is a divine gift directly from you. We gratefully accept this precious gift and give thanks that joy can be experienced by us, not just during the Christmas times, but every day of the year. As we contemplate the birth of Jesus in that humble manger, let us remember this simple prayer. May you be filled with the wonder of Mary, the devotion of Joseph, the joy of the angels, the eagerness of the shepherds, the determination of the Magi, and the peace of the Christ child. United in consciousness and buoyed by the love that never ends, we now give thanks in advance for today's lesson that galvanizes our spiritual growth, for the music that uplifts us and delights us, for the wonderful spiritual family whose love, support, and prayers sustain us. For these and for all of our blessings, dear God, we give great thanks, saying, so it is, and so we let it be. Amen. In lieu of reading the daily word today, I'm going to share a Unity Advent message with you this morning. It's a story by Reverend Kurt Condra, who is the senior minister at Unity on the North Shore in Evanston, Illinois. Reverend Condra writes, at my church, the high point of our early Christmas Eve service, designed especially for families with children, always involves filing past a creche and peering into a manger. Now, this being Unity, instead of seeing a doll or an infant, all who look inside that manger witness their own reflection in a mirror resting atop a pile of hay. The obvious point being, Christ is born in you. Now, no matter what age the kids are, they always seem to understand, albeit at different levels. For example, the youngest children recognize that the face looking back at them is their own. Starting at around age 6, they realize that their face is the face of God. And the older children understand that God is in everyone. That's the follow-up lesson for adults. We grow and we give birth to Christ consciousness throughout our whole lives. If we stay awake, the meaning of Christmas continues to evolve in us. Our understanding of ourselves, our relationship with God, and our capacity to express the joy of infinite spirit, to give birth to the Christ, those things become more powerful and more fulfilling every day. Of course, we don't present it to the kids in those terms. So instead, we ask them to think about what Christmas used to mean to them and what it means now. Maybe it used to be about Santa and getting presents, but now it's about receiving and giving. Maybe it used to be about cookies and candy, but now it's about gratitude and celebrations. I encourage you to take stock of your own evolving Christ consciousness. How is your experience of Christmas different from years past? Especially now in this age of pandemic, perhaps there's a new character in the Christmas pageant of your life. Perhaps the budget is tight and the costumes and the scenery aren't quite exactly what you desire. Perhaps someone that you love has transitioned to another realm or has been cast in a different role in your life. Are you exploring new ways to express your appreciation and acknowledge the blessings unfolding in your life? Are you discovering wonder and joy? Are you allowing peace and love to be born anew within you? Remember, like children peering into the mirrored manger, whatever insights that you gain are but a snapshot of your ever-expanding realization of your innate divinity. Bless those snapshots and know that tidings of great joy await. Today's Advent passage was inspired by Psalm chapter 16, verse 11, which says, "You show me the path of life. In your presence, there is fullness of joy. In your right hand are pleasures forevermore." So it is, and so we let it be. Amen.
Okay, and if you want to join in on the other bits, it's an evolution, you know, say what you like, and it's on the wall, and it doesn't, those bits aren't important, you know, that's just to fill in. Yeah. Okay?
One, two, three, four.
And so this is Christmas, and what have you done? Another year over, and a new one just begun. And so this is Christmas, I hope you have fun. The near and the dear ones, the old and the young, a very Merry Christmas and a Happy New Year. Let's hope it's a good one, without any fear. And so this is Christmas, for weak and for strong, for rich and the poor ones. The road is so long, and so happy Christmas, for black and for white, for yellow and red ones. Let's stop all the fight. A very Merry Christmas and a Happy New Year. Let's hope it's a good one, without any fear. And so this is Christmas, and what have you done? Another year over, and a new one just begun. And so happy Christmas, I hope you have fun. The near and the dear ones, the old.
and with the notes of that beautiful music just resonating within us. Let's move now into a time of quiet contemplation, going within and resting in the sacred stillness of God's presence. Find a comfortable position and focus on that place within where God indwells you as you allow my words to be your own. As Christmas approaches, joy dawns in my grateful heart. God's gift of joy is infinite and always accessible to me. The joy of the Lord is my strength. Moment by moment, I let the love and joy of God shine through me, a healing gift to all the world. I stir up the joy that God has implanted in my heart and express this joy in life. God's everlasting love enfolds me, upholds me, and gives me joy and strength. As we go deeper in the silence, rest in this truth. The joy of God overflows in my heart, shines through my smile, and echoes in every word from my mouth. Oh, thank you, sweet spirit. Thank you for this time of rest in your presence. Thank you for this deepening understanding that your gift of joy is mine to claim and to express. Thank you for allowing us to remember your presence, your love, your protection, your prosperity are with us always. And for this, we are so grateful. And from this place of deep connection with God, I'm going to now ask you to affirm our statement of truth with me from your heart. I'm going to say it once and ask you to speak it aloud, knowing that the word has power. There is only one presence and one power in my life and in the universe, God the good. Let us now say that together. There is only one presence and one power active in my life and in the universe, God the good. Let us also affirm the powerful prayer written by Charles Fillmore that says, I rest in quietness and confidence after I have spoken the word of truth, knowing that good results will follow. It's time now to return your awareness back to this time and place, feeling spiritually refreshed and renewed as we affirm, so it is and so we let it be. Amen. And now it is my delight to introduce our guest speaker to you today. Reverend TJ Woodward was a hit from the very first time he spoke to our congregation, and we are thrilled to welcome him back. TJ is a best-selling author. He is an inspirational speaker. He is a revolutionary recovery expert who has helped countless people through his simple and yet very powerful, profound teachings. He was the founding minister at the Agape Bay area in Oakland. But now he's down in Southern California living in Marina del Rey, and we're just so delighted that he has chosen to join us today. Please welcome the incomparable Reverend TJ Woodward.
Peace and blessings. Happy holidays. I'm so incredibly delighted to be with your community again, and it's truly, truly an honor to be sharing my talk today. And the talk is titled A Celebration of Light, Viewing the Christmas Story Through the Mystical Lens. So as we are entering the winter solstice, the holiday season, regardless of what tradition we come from, or maybe we don't have a tradition we came from regarding the holidays, the Christmas story is a story that we can use as an indicator or a guidepost of how we can embrace the light within ourselves and be the light in the world. So what does it mean to interpret a story through the mystical lens? Very simply said, the mystical lens is a recognition that it's all happening within us. It's all an inner journey, much more so than an outer journey. When I was pretty early in my spiritual path, I became really fascinated with dream interpretation. And I remember reading books like, what does it mean if I dream about water in a dream? Or what does it mean if I'm in a car going really fast? And I kept finding all these different definitions. And then when I entered ministerial school at Unity, we were taught to use the Metaphysical Bible Dictionary. Now, what was that? That was Charles Fillmore's interpretation of stories from the Bible. And once again, there was information there on what these certain words mean, what these concepts mean, what the different characters meant. And I realized at some point, although that was really helpful for me, at some point I recognized that it wasn't as important what someone else said about a way to interpret either a dream or a story. It was really about asking the question, what does this story mean to me? And that's what I'm inviting for you to take a look at. What does the Christmas story mean to you? What does it mean to celebrate light? Hanukkah celebrates light. A lot of the solstice traditions look at the light because so many people, at least in the Northern Hemisphere, we recognize that the longest night of the year is the solstice, somewhere around December 21st, and we're almost there. And so oftentimes what I hear people say about this time of year is we're moving back into the light. We're moving into having more light in our lives. And I do think that's important. I also want to add to the story that in addition to celebrating the light, we also want to honor and recognize the darkness and the importance of darkness. Nature gives us a lot of information. And I share this often, so if I shared this before, that's okay, because it seems to be what's present in this moment. If you imagine that you are planting a seed, you're not going to put it in direct sunlight, because if the seed only gets light, what happens? The seed won't grow. The seed will burn. The seed will actually not produce the plant that it's wanting to birth. What is needed is for it to go into fertile soil and to take some time there before the process of emerging into new life. And if you look at a human being, we spend 9 months or so in the womb, and that womb time is very important. Obviously, if a baby is born premature, they might have a lot of health issues and need a lot of extra attention. So the time in the womb, the gestation period, the time in the fertile soil, all of that is to be honored as well as the light. And so for me, if I look at this story of the birth of a new consciousness, because in New Thought teachings, that's what we say Christmas is. It's a recognition. It's a celebration. It's honoring the birth of a new consciousness. And that birth does not happen without also honoring the time in the darkness. And so as we move beyond duality, beyond the idea of good and bad and right and wrong, we can start to embrace all parts of the journey. And why is this important? It's important because if I don't honor the time in the darkness, the time tending to creating the conditions for growth, then the growth itself won't happen, or at least won't happen in the way that it wants to flourish. So let's break that down a little bit. The metaphor is obvious, but in my life, what that means is I honor through spiritual practice the preparation for the birth of a new consciousness. And it's very seductive to focus on the birth. Oh, I want more love in my life. I want more light in my life. And I know that that can be, or I'll speak for myself, that was a trap early in my journey in New Thought. Oh my gosh, I love this. I'm going to use affirmations and I'm going to have more love and light in my life. And of course, that's what I want. I'm imagining that's what we all want. More love, more connection, more light, more ease. And I also at one point recognized the importance of the practice of going within. And so the mystical interpretation of this celebration of light is to recognize what needs to be created or what I need to embrace in order to create this birth of a new consciousness. And so if I move beyond the ideas that light is good and dark is bad, we've been deeply programmed to move beyond that program and to recognize the importance of all of it equally, then what gets born is so much more profound than what would get born when I'm chasing the light. So let's talk about what's happening in our world and in our country. It would be really easy right now to look at some of the conditions of the world and call them bad or wrong. With just a slight shift in awareness, we can begin to ask the question, what is wanting to get born? What is it we are preparing for during this time of seeming difficulty? And rather than rejecting that or thinking there's something bad here and we need to get rid of it, what if we could look at it through the lens of oneness? And I'll go a little deeper into this. We are beginning to recognize that there is one life. Now, unity and New Thought principles have been saying this for over 100 years. Some of the great mystical teachings have been saying this for thousands of years, that we are intrinsically all one. So if it's true that oneness is our birthright, oneness is the greater reality, then I also recognize that the evolution of consciousness is not only happening individually or our perception of the individual, it also happens in the collective. This is important because it could be easy to think, well, there's not really much I can do about what's happening in the world. Or maybe if you're anything like me, you might have been in, or maybe you are still sometimes, or in this moment, in the idea that we must fight. We must change what's happening in the world. When I recognize that really it's happening in consciousness, I recognize that the greatest gift I can offer the world is my own transformation. My own transformation into a deeper awareness of my true nature, of the oneness that exists at the core of life. And so what I'm not saying is we don't recognize the seeming differences or the seeming separation or even the seeming conflict that's happening in our world. What I am saying is we honor that, and at the same time, we recognize that there's something greater happening. There's a greater reality than division. So let's talk about that, the Christmas story, and how it relates to what's happening in our world. If it's true that we are all one, and in my own individual journey, I recognized that a big part of my healing was bringing what was in the shadow or the darkness into the light, honoring it, looking at all the ideas, the beliefs, the concepts, the ideologies that I had in my unconscious that maybe I wasn't even aware of. And so in New Thought, I came into the idea of affirmations affirm the light. But what I did, and I don't think this is what New Thought is suggesting, but how I interpreted it was reject the darkness and turn to the light. And then I realized the importance of this honoring what's in the shadow, honoring what I've buried deeply in my subconscious, and recognizing that as difficult as some of that may be to look at, to embrace, to even honor and celebrate, wow, I can even celebrate things that seem difficult. I can recognize that what needed to happen in my own journey is for what was in the darkness to come up to conscious awareness, to be honored, to be healed. And if it's true that we're all one, then we could also say that it's true that that's what's happening in our world today. There are unconscious beliefs, biases, and points of view that have been in many ways running the world, running the show. And what we're called to at this time, we're called to bring that into conscious awareness, and that's a moment-to-moment choice. To recognize that, yes, sometimes I can perceive that there is an other, but perceiving the other is at the root of all conflict, and quite frankly, the root of suffering. When I see myself as separate from other people, and to take it a little deeper, when I see myself as separate from source energy, God essence, essential beingness, the matrix, whatever word we use for this divine energy, when I see myself as separate from that, I suffer. When I honor the path that I've chosen, including the path of separating from that, which of course we know isn't true. We never really separate from source, but consciously I separated, or even unconsciously. Maybe I forgot the deeper reality, the truth, that each of us is a perfect expression of the one power. And that's unity's first principle. There is one power and one presence active in the world and in my life. God, the good, omnipotent. And if the word God doesn't work, we could say source, the infinite. And when I really understand that, not just intellectually, but experientially, recognize that everything that has ever happened in my life has been an invitation to know that more deeply. Every relationship I've ever had, in all the joy and the love and the connection and all the discordance and the seeming separation and the pain, all of it has been there for me to awaken to a greater reality. So that's really the Christmas story to me. It is the symbolic birth of the light, the symbolic birth of a new consciousness, the symbolic birth of a new way of being and seeing, of recognizing that we can be the light in the world rather than seeking the light in the world. Let's take a moment with that. To be the light in the world rather than to seek the light in the world. That to me is freedom. That to me is purpose and meaning. And so as we celebrate and cultivate an awareness of what we might call the dark, the shadow, parts of ourselves that maybe we don't really want to admit are there, if I can look at that with compassion and understanding and recognize that everything is that has happened can be an opportunity. I want to take a moment and really lean into something we hear a lot in our culture. It's very popular. And that is, everything happens for a reason. When something difficult happens, maybe we say, well, everything happens for a reason. There's something good that's going to come from this. And of course, that can seem really true on one level. What I want to invite is not this or that, but this and that. Yes, that may be true. And it also may be true that life is happening. And I create the meaning of what just happened. One person can get a diagnosis that seems difficult, or we might even call horrible, and they have an experience of anger or why me, pain or sadness. And another person can receive that information and say, wow, what am I going to make the rest of my life mean? Now, what I'm speaking to here with the birth of a new consciousness is actually embracing and integrating all of those parts of ourself. In other words, something happens, it's okay to be sad. It's okay to be angry. It's okay to feel hurt. And guess what? It's also okay to feel joy and connection and love. Sometimes in the midst of something that seems so terrible, we have an opportunity, and sometimes we even have an instant awakening. Wow. Life is presenting me with an opportunity to more fully love myself and the world. I can honor the entire emotional experience. I think the new reality is really one of integrating all aspects of self, physical, intellectual, emotional, and spiritual. When we recognize that all four of those are valid, we can then embrace all those aspects of ourselves and ask the question, what gets created when I only live in physical reality? What gets created when I only live in intellectual reality? In other words, I'm going to figure all this out. What happens when I only live in emotional reality, honoring my feelings? Some might even say, get stuck in my feelings. In my experience, the emotional room is an invitation to love ourselves more deeply. What if I decided whatever I'm feeling is perfectly appropriate? I worked with a woman once who had been the caretaker for her mother, who had been in the process of dying, or transitioning, as we say, for a decade. When her mother finally made her transition, she felt relief, she felt love, she felt light, she felt joy. And yet everyone kept saying, oh, you must be so sad that your mother died. And she felt like it wasn't okay for her to say, actually, I feel joy and relief for her, for me, for all involved. And so what is it like for us to honor whatever emerges? And then we move into this spiritual room that we could also call the mystical room, where we recognize that we have moved beyond duality. The new consciousness that has been born, that is represented by the Christmas story, by all the solstice celebrations, is that as we have integrated all parts of ourselves, we wake up to the greater reality that underneath all of it, at the core of all of it, is love, is source, is infinite beingness. And as we experience that, and as we integrate all parts of self, honoring the physical, honoring the intellectual, honoring the emotional, we can more quickly and more solidly move into the awareness that love is who we are, joy is who we are. That's our natural state. We came into the world as whole and perfect spiritual beings. And most of us have been programmed to believe all kinds of BS belief systems that have told us other than that. So the spiritual journey isn't really a destination as much as it is a remembering. And the Christmas story is a symbol of that. At any moment, I can tune into this greater reality. I can recognize that I am a perfect expression of love and of light. And that is the truth for you, and it's the truth for all living beings on planet Earth and in the cosmos. And that I'm not separate from that. And because we're not separate from that, we also have a divine purpose. Because as we awaken to our greater reality, our true nature, the world awakens. So if you want a shortcut to living a life filled with joy, love, and light, the shortcut is right in this moment, recognizing that there's a blueprint within you for a divinity. As a matter of fact, it's who and what you are. And the Christmas story represents the birth of that awareness. It's not really the birth of a new consciousness. It's a spontaneous awareness, a spontaneous insight. Our beloved Michael Bernard Beckwith says we grow in two ways, through pain or insight. The choice is yours. We grow in two ways, through pain or insight. The choice is yours. And this story represents that choice, this awareness that at any moment we can honor the conditions of the world, we can honor the conditions of physical reality, and we can also tap into this greater reality. The spiritual insight is quite simple: to recognize who we really are. And when we know that and we be that in the world, everything changes. This is the story, the mystical interpretation, the celebration of light. Thank you so much. I'm so deeply honored. And what I want to say in closing is very simple. You are the light of the world. You are the one who has been chosen right now to incarnate on planet Earth, to birth this greater reality. And again, the reality is really an awareness of that which has always existed. And so here we are, being called. Be the love, be the light, be the joy. So incredibly grateful. Peace and blessings.
The sun is shining, the grass is green, the orange and palm trees sway. There's never been such a day in Beverly Hills, LA. But it's December the 24th, and I'm longing to be up north. I'm dreaming of a white Christmas, just like the ones I used to know, where the tree tops glisten.
Oh my goodness. Thank you to our music team for this beautiful Christmas song. And if that doesn't put you in the Christmas spirit, the prayer team is available to pray for you. And Reverend TJ Woodward, thank you so much for that valuable lesson on the deeper meaning of the winter solstice and the old Christmas stories. I just love how this perspective can help us to create a birth of a new and higher consciousness. And now, this is the time in our service where we offer our gifts to the place that spiritually nurtures us, Unity of Ventura. When we practice the spiritual principle of giving to the place where we are spiritually fed, we then activate the spiritual principle of giving and receiving. And that means that doors are opened for you for your highest good, allowing that good to appear faster and easier. Who wouldn't want that? And by supporting the place where you are spiritually nurtured, you allow the unity message to keep going, helping spiritually feed and uplift others. So for that, we thank you. Now, if you have watched one of our other programs, you know that there are a whole bunch of ways for you to give. If you need any direction on that, just go to our website, unityofventura.org. There's a donate button there. But just know that whatever methods you choose to donate, in whatever amounts you are guided to give, we are so grateful for your support. So let's take a moment to turn inward. I invite you to find that place within, that sacred spot of infinite abundance, love, and peace that indwells you. And as you rest in that wonderful indwelling presence, it's from that sacred space that I invite you to align with this statement. I give joyfully, willingly, lovingly. I give joyfully, willingly, lovingly. And as that statement resonates within you, please hold your gift first in your heart and then in your hand as we bless it with our offering blessing. I'll say the blessing once and then ask you from your heart to join me in saying it. Divine love through me blesses and multiplies all that I have. Divine love through me blesses and multiplies all that I give. Divine love through me blesses and multiplies all that I receive. Let's say that together, knowing that when two or more are gathered, amazing things happen. Divine love through me blesses and multiplies all that I have. divine love through me blesses and multiplies all that I give. Divine love through me blesses and multiplies all that I receive. Oh, sweet Spirit, we just take this moment to acknowledge and to bless these gifts offered today. We know that the gifts have been given so joyfully, so willingly, so lovingly. We affirm that these gifts are used to further the will and the work of God through this ministry. We acknowledge, thank, and bless each giver, knowing that they have been open and receptive to divine guidance, and that they have given to us from a place of infinite loving kindness and generosity. We affirm that you, dear God, are richly blessing each giver in magnificent, wondrous, and miraculous ways for sharing of their prosperity with us. So it is. Amen. And now, in the spirit of prosperity and abundance, let's thank once again Reverend TJ Woodward for his wonderful lesson. Let's send a blessing of gratitude to our incredible music team. And let's join together in offering a very deep and joyful prayer of thanksgiving for two people for whom Unity wouldn't be able to work. First is Smitty West for his amazing behind-the-scenes magic that brings you these services. And also for Jana Rector, who keeps the ship of Unity on course and afloat. Now, as we begin to close our service today, I have a couple of announcements. First, due to your wonderful generosity, Unity was able to raise $903 that will be used to provide Amazon gift cards to the children at the White House Women and Children's Home at the Rescue Mission in Ventura. We are just so proud of you and your generosity. Thank you so much. I'd like you to take just a moment and feel good about that accomplishment and think about how delighted those kids are going to be. Second, the Board of Trustees is delighted and thrilled to announce that we will be using the Poinsettia Pavilion starting in February to hold in-person services for any of those who are interested in joining together in person. We will also continue hybrid services, Zooming for those people who aren't either nearby or who aren't ready to show up in person. Additional details will be following in the coming weeks. Third, please check your newsletter. There's a link this week that came out last Wednesday and in the upcoming Wednesday newsletter for an encore presentation of the incredible music Christmas service that Smitty and Julia and their talented musical associates have made. If you are not in the Christmas spirit, this indeed will get you there. So I invite you, check your newsletter for that link. And finally, if you or anyone else might be going through some times of darkness, like Reverend TJ mentioned, please reach out. Allow the prayer team to hold the high watch for you, to affirm that that light is constantly shining, whether you can see it or not. It would be their joy to support you. So let them know either by calling the church office or by sending an email. They would be honored to hold the high watch for you. We now conclude our service by singing the peace song, saying the prayer for protection, and by inviting each of you to join us again next week. It would not be Unity of Ventura without you. Thank you, and God bless.
Let there be peace on earth, and let it begin with me. Let there be peace on earth, the peace that was meant to be. With God as our creator, family all are we.
each moment and live each moment in peace eternally. Let there be peace on earth and let it begin with me.
The light of God surrounds us. The love of God enfolds us. The power of God protects us. The presence of God washes over us. Wherever we are, God is, and all is well.